Hello and welcome to Byte Size. Today's episode is all about DOS executables and scripts. You know how I love such relevant subjects for today. Ah, command line operating systems, my favourite. These were the days when installing new software meant navigating to the A drive, requesting a directory listing, finding the necessary installation program, and typing out its file name to execute. Then, post-installation, you could navigate to your new directory, find the program file, and execute that, likely only to be told that you've run out of conventional memory or something to that effect. Glorious times, indeed. But finding these executables to run wasn't always straightforward. Some software could contain multiple executables, and it was your job to work out which one sounded like it was most appropriate for the task. You might, for instance, have a game installed in a directory with run.bat, game.exe, execute.com, setup.exe, executables which were all present. Of course, you could look at the readme.txt file for instructions, or just go ahead and run what felt like the most appropriate. Usually it was a bat file, and that's because a bat file is simply a set of DOS commands bundled into a text file, a DOS script, if you will. The .bat extension actually stands for batch, as it's a batch of DOS statements.
Dr. Spatzel, my creative labs.
Therefore, the reason for its presence is usually to run the correct executable with the correct command line options, or even a setup file first if you haven't already done so. Now, batch files could actually be incredibly complex. I remember creating a jumping menu for my PC, which ran on boot and provided a nice friendly set of options for me to choose. You massive nerd! So what about the actual executables themselves, specifically .com and .exe, in the good old DOS days? Well, let's start with .com files, with the .com standing for command. This is the original program file, one inherited from Digital Research's CPM operating system, which was really the baseline for 86DOS on its inception. Microsoft would of course purchase 86DOS from Seattle Computer Products, and the rest is history, but the basis of the .com file would remain the same. Rather than being in a particular format, a .com file is really just a memory image. DOS would simply pick up the file contents, plonk it into memory at a fixed address, and then run the 16-bit machine code. Perhaps the most well-known file to use this extension is the DOS command line interpreter, command.com, which would relinquish and load itself back into memory after a program had finished running. However, this basic implementation meant that file sizes were limited to 64 kilobytes, which was fine for most programs in the early 80s, especially running on the CPM, but with the additional memory offered by IBM PC compatibles, requirements outgrew this limitation, and this is where we get the .exe extension. .exe stands for executable and makes up for the shortfalls of .com files. Originally, these executables were based around the MZ format, named after Microsoft coder Mark Zabowski. At its most basic level, this meant that the header of an .exe file starts with the letters MZ, but also defined the structure of the files. Executables allowed for much larger programs, especially when DOS extenders came into use, and also laid the foundations for Windows and even OS 2 to use similar structures, all bundled under the .exe extension. Newer executables that ran under these operating systems, and even multitasking DOS 4, used the ASCII identifier of NE, standing for New Executable, and could be packed with resources such as bitmap graphics and anything else you want, all contained in one nice package. Of course, we still use derivatives of this in Windows even today. It was around this time where we also witnessed the lines blur between .com and .exe files. DOS utilities like edit.com and even command.com were increasing in size, and so new rules were required to allow their size to exceed 64 kilobytes. Adding flexibility into the DOS program loader meant that .com and .exe could be used interchangeably, but still running fine, with the operating system seeking header information and determining how to load the file where appropriate. With 32-bit versions of Windows, however, both the .com file and, for the majority of users, batch files became irrelevant, and we moved to what you may call a less diverse culture of executables, although we'll get to things like .msi files in another episode. Regardless, we should cover something important before I leave, something which sometimes caused me issues as I tried to work out why my executable wasn't running as expected, and that is run order. Throughout their time, the run order of these DOS files has remained the same. If you have three executables with the same name but different extensions, they'll run in this order: .com.exe.bat. I always thought that it would be better to put batch files first, so you could sneak some extra command line options in there without confusing the end user, but you know, it doesn't really matter. So if you want to run bob.exe but you've got bob.com in the same directory, then typing bob will just run the .com file. That is, unless you type their extensions as well, bob.exe for example, in the command line. So, I hope that has cleared up a mystery that I'm sure has been nagging you for the past almost 40 years. I, for one, feel a whole ton better. Oh, by the way, .com files have nothing to do with internet top-level domains like .com. We'll cover that another time. Anyway, thanks for watching. More videos here. You can support me, you can subscribe, thumb up or thumb down, in any case. Have a great evening.